Good morning and welcome on your live safari experience. We've got all kinds of magical animals here from this beautiful spring morning in the African bush. And we're going to try and bring you anything from elephants to the smallest beetle and all the little things in between, because this is Safari Live. Are jumping on the back of Wendy and my favorite time to be out in the African bush, just that moment before sunrise with the pre-dawn light streaming through and all a sense of expectation to see what wonderful things we can find. So we are coming to you live from Juma, Arethusa and Cheetah Plains Game Reserve in the Sabi Sand in the Greater Kruger National Park area of South Africa. My name is Jamie, and this morning I have Brian on camera with me, and of course the thumb always accompanies Brian. They are best friends. Some would say they are joined at the not hip but hand. And not only are we live, but we're also interactive, which means that you can send through your questions on hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. What an extraordinary drive we had yesterday on the Sunset Safari, for those of you who missed it. The Nkuhumas on their buffalo kill with their gorgeous little cubs, the Sticks and their gorgeous little cubs, and two leopards. For me, a new one in Kanyeni. I've never seen her before yesterday. She is absolutely stunning, and in fact, it nearly turned into a double sighting with the Sticks and in Kanyeni, but in Kanyeni proved to be as elusive as leopards are, and she ducked away without the lions spotting her. And then James, of course, had Tingana. So we had a truly magical sunset safari yesterday, catfold. This morning, I'm going to just trundle around and see what I can find. Who knows what happened last night? Perhaps the Queen of Juma decided to return to us once again. She keeps popping onto Juma and then disappearing off again to the south of our boundary. So hopefully she decides to make an appearance. And I'm secretly hoping, I'm going to go trundle along the southern boundary, because I'm secretly hoping that at some point Karula's daughter Tundi might decide to make an appearance. She was around the Mulwanini yesterday, moving between Chitwa and Torchwood, both places where we can't go at this point. But she does have two brand new little cubs that we have yet to see. And since Tundi is definitely high up there on my list of favorite leopards to see, I can't wait to be able to be introduced to her little bundles of joy. But we'll see, because we say we have a plan in the morning, but truth is we all know that nothing ever goes according to plan, and you never quite know what direction the morning is going to take you in. You know, we could come around the corner, there could be a lion. We could come around the corner, there could be an elephant. We'll just have to wait and see. There's a zebra, but it's very far away. Some stripy horses, not yet out of their pajamas, as Brent would say, hiding away between the trees and enjoying an early morning breakfast. And Debbie, absolutely, Debbie says dawn is by far her favorite moment of her day. I couldn't agree more. And I often wonder if perhaps the general game species, like these beautiful zebra, don't agree with us. Oh, itch. Have a good neck scratch there. When you don't have thumbs, the trees will have to do. But what I mean is, imagine, they've gone through a dark and scary night knowing that there's predators out there. I bet there's a sense of relief as soon as the sun starts to rise and the bush is bathed in the early morning light. It is, of course, the best time to be out and about. The nocturnal creatures are still moving around, the lions and the leopards, it's not too warm. And all of our general game species are waking up, having a stretch, and in this case, having a scratch. Well, that's exactly the right spot. Here we go. Oh, now we go onto the back. Other side. What a perfectly placed log, exactly right for the zebra's purposes. Going to have breakfast and a scratch, or just the scratch? Just the scratch. Can understand exactly why, with his beautiful heart-shaped nose. That was a little bit of a sly wink there, Brian. I think that was at you. Little nick around the ear. Looking fluffy and warm in the spring morning chill, and a little bit thin. All of our animals that are herbivores out here are starting to struggle in terms of meeting their nutritional requirements. I've been away for 2 weeks, I've only just recently come back, and the change in the landscape is noticeable as we get further and further. The temperature's heating up now, every day is going close to 30 degrees or 86 degrees Fahrenheit, which means that whatever remaining moisture is in the soil or the air or in any of the dams is evaporating exceptionally quickly. And as a ruminant, he's got a slightly, and a mixed feeder actually, so he's capable of eating leaves and grass. He's got a slightly easier time of things than the zebra that we were looking at earlier, but not by much. Beautiful old gentleman. You can see his horns are starting to smooth out at the base. Rings of keratin forming ridges along them, making him most impressive. Standing, ruminating, and enjoying the dip in temperature before the sun starts to peek over the horizon. You sort of have to feel for waterbuck because, as the name suggests, they like water. They often see them whenever you go to the Kruger National Park, wander and drive along the river systems. You'll see them standing knee, ankle deep in water, munching on the soft grasses, but of course that's not something that they can do at the moment. Thank you, boy. You are beautiful, but the morning awaits, and I've heard a report that there are some elephants just ahead of us. Oh, I think we'll leave our waterbuck bull for now and carry on and see if we can't catch up with them. So yes, the great final control move has come with several gremlins, including knocking Rusty out of commission briefly this morning. However, Rusty is back up and running, and the wonderful, eloquent Mr. Henry would like to say good morning in his truly wonderful way.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome to this end of the Sunrise Safari. Well done, Gendre. That was very well picked up by you. Gendre, you may have picked up, is on camera. So there will be abuse flowing at a great speed from the front of the car to the back throughout the course of the drive. The sun has just peeped up over the eastern horizon. Rusty, the recalcitrant old bag that she is finally ready, and we're now moving. And we're going to go and see if we can find the lions. My name is James Hendry, in case you were wondering. If you don't care, that's all right too. But you can address me as such, and you can do that the best way. We are live, as Jamie has no doubt told you. Hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv. Those are the two best methods of communicating with us. Aye. We're just greeting Taxon, saying hello to him. He's going out. I think he's also heading towards the lions. Now, I don't know if they're going to be there still. And for those of you who don't know, they were sitting on their buffalo carcass yesterday evening. I thought perhaps it was going to be finished by the time this morning rolled around. But we'll go and have a look. The morning is fresh and glorious. And wherever they have gone, I've no doubt their pug marks will appear on the road, and we'll follow them from there. Isn't that a lovely picture? Very nice, Gendre.
Yes, thank Taxon for the dust.
Yes, well done, Taxon. You're right, it's got nothing to do with you, it's all Taxon. And again, a relatively subdued dawn chorus. I'm largely made up of birchall starlings. One or two crested barbets going, and the lovely dulcet tones of a generator powering the new final control. That's all I can hear, actually. Right, let's get away from the final control. The new final control, everybody. It's spanky. You're not even allowed to wear shoes in there, you know. Not sure that's a good thing. I mean, it's all very well trying to keep the carpet clean, but I don't know, there's something quite offensive. I mean, what would you rather have, Gendre? Dust or toe jam?
Yes, it doesn't smell as nice as a man, does it?
No, exactly. So let's just hope the directors are cleaning their feet before they go in there. Now, I believe there was a lioness at the dam cam during the course of the night. So the fact that there was only one tells me maybe only one of them came for a drink. I'm sure it was one of the Nkuhumas. And she's gone back towards... Look. That's a lovely sound as well, isn't it, Gendre?
Yeah, it is.
That is a red-billed buffalo weaver carrying a stick. A very, very large stick. Looks like of an Acacia Girardii tree, and he's going to go and put it in his nest, which I suspect is on the tower that broadcasts this very signal to you. Keepers, how he stays in the air with that thing. Can you still see him there? Is he behind the tree? There he goes. Look at that! Isn't that amazing? He's going to the tower. No, he's having a rest. He's just having a rest there. You can just see him going. Not far now. Can you imagine how heavy that must be? It's like carrying a very large log in your mouth. Let's see where he makes it to. Is he on the tower?
Yeah.
Brilliant. Good. That isn't actually the tower that we're broadcasting from, but it is a tower of sorts. And Stefan has had to clean that tower out of the red-billed buffalo weaver's nest at various times. And he comes back covered in scratches. And most importantly, he comes covered in mites and various things that then bite him. And he looks like he has a pox for the next week. Now, there is also a birchall starling, Gendre. Do you see this rather splendid bird sitting very close to us in the sunlight? Oh, such artistry. That is the birchall starling, everybody. He's very close, you know. He's only about 3 meters from us. So close that I might, in fact, attempt a picture. No doubt, being the world's slowest wildlife photographer, this bird will have had new chicks by the time I manage to depress the shutter. Ooh. Isn't it beautiful? Oh, that's stunning. That really is very special. Look at that. And look at the gold off the chest, off the breast. That might be my top... My very top virtual starling sighting ever. Well done, Jandre. On we go. What a good start. Birds galore. Right, let's head across to Jamie. She's got something slightly larger than a virtual starling, and I will hopefully see you with some lion cubbies shortly.
Definitely slightly larger than a virtual starling, although he's doing a fantastic job of hiding behind one very small bush. We have a magnificent elephant bull. Just look at those incredible thick tusks. You can see where he's sheared off both of them. Those were probably much, much longer, but of course, because they are tools, they get utilized in multiple different ways, and as a result often break off, although I suspect this gentleman would have lost at least part of that tusk in a fight with another male. It's an old break, but you can see where it's sheared off at the tip. And he is absolutely beautiful. We've actually stumbled upon an entire elephant herd. The rest of them are in front of me, but unfortunately my way is blocked. Not completely, but I have a feeling that if I were to attempt to sneak around this gentleman, who is in the prime of his life, he might object to it. So for now, we'll settle with this lovely view of him hiding behind a quarry bush. It's been interesting to watch the way in which the elephant feeding behavior has changed over the last few months. Yesterday we saw one poor elephant bull attempting to tackle a spikethorn thicket, which, speaking from personal experience, is not terribly appetizing. Brian, you've eaten spikethorn before.
I think so.
Yeah, it's not a nice... It takes all of the saliva out of your mouth. It just is not very pleasant at all. Now the elephants are targeting the gwari bushes, which are the only remaining green trees, one of the only remaining green trees at the moment. But they will be in luck because hopefully the knobthorns are going to start getting their fresh green spring leaves soon, which will provide a welcome respite from their current rather boring diet. Such a lovely, peaceful way to start off a morning. You can see the rest of the ellies at the back. I've seen quite a few little ones trundling about the place, and I will try and sneak past this gentleman at some point to get us a slightly closer view. You can see younger little elephants with their tusks just peeking through, moving about at the back there. The wonderful news is, once we do decide to leave these elephants, although I'm not in any kind of a hurry, Herbert, the wonderful Herbert, our fantastic tracker, has just come upon fresh tracks, according to him, of a Karula coming back onto Juma. So everybody keep your fingers crossed and your hopes held high that this morning is the morning that we finally get to see the Queen of Juma once again. That lovely female leopard. I know that I'm keen to catch up with her and hopefully have a chance to see her lovely cubs. But for now, elephants in the morning sunlight is equally spectacular. Copy that. Whereabouts are you?
Simon's Catland, Pezupin Senior, Impala Kill.
Copy, Herbert, I'm on my way. Well, you know, Brian, we were on Philemon's cut line. We must have turned around just before We found her. So, for those of you who might have missed that happy conversation with Herbert, I didn't understand every word of it, but enough to get what he was saying, and he has just found a fresh impala kill on Philemon's cut line. So unfortunately, Elise, as lovely as you are, I'm going to be making my way there straight away. Let's go and see which leopard we've got. I'm not sure which one it is. I don't know if it's Karula. I don't know if it's Tingana. Sorry, Elise, you are lovely. And we shall return to you, depending on how the morning goes. So while we race across to go and join Herbert and see what he's got for us, let's jump on board with James and find out what his plans are.
Herbert is very clever, everybody. He's managed to find something very nice for you. Jamie will no doubt shortly reveal the great morning surprise. We are now heading along Hyena Road towards the lions. And before we get there, we're hopefully going to get you a shot of the grey-headed bushrike that just flew across the road. You got it. Shall I stop? Forward? Back? Sideways? You got him. Yes. Look at that. Beautiful. Grey-headed bushrike. Looks beautiful. Quite a nasty fellow. He will look for nesting birds. He basically will kill anything smaller than him with that rather vicious shrike's tooth. That's really quite a nice sighting of a grey-headed bushrike, everyone. And they've got the most haunting call, which of course, as many of you will know, gives rise to their Afrikaans name, Spookvoël, which means ghost bird. They go... Clearly not quite like that, or that bird would be calling back at me. They also have a funny little alarm call that goes... which is quite amusing to watch. What they do is they go... Hello, Chizzy Leo. Is that the correct name? Chizzy Leo? Hello, Chizzy Leo. Good morning to you. You want to know what the smallest bird we get here is? The smallest bird we get here is something called the grey penduline tit. It's about that big. So not quite as small as the bumblebee hummingbird. It would be just over an inch tall. That thing's about sort of 2 inches long. I will show you a picture as we drive along here. Such is my tremendous driving skills, Rondre. Of course, the person who will be sacrificed while I drive and look at books is you, because I will have to hit a tree or two, maybe. The grey penduline tit. Tit for tit. 328. Oh, and maybe under for penduline tit. Yes, I think it is. Indeed. Chandra, you should never drive and read, you know that. No, it's very dangerous. Luckily, we're not going very far. There's a small hole in front of us. I think I'm just going to do this, actually. I thought I might be able to succeed, but I have failed. I am trying to be better, Chandra. There. The great penduline tit. That's not the great penduline tit, Chandra. That's the sunrise. Here is the grey penduline tit. See, he's a very cute little bird. And he's only 8 to 9 centimetres, which is, well, I mean, that's actually a little over 2 inches. Beautiful. You also get something in the Cape called a Cape penduline tit. The Cape penduline tit rather like the residents of Cape Town, a much slower bird. Gets up very late in the morning, doesn't do much work. Stephanie, I can't believe I've forgotten this. You say, am I enjoying the apricity of this morning? I am enjoying the apricity, I think, but I've forgotten what apricity means. I can't believe that I've forgotten it. And I know it's what... Oh, the warmth of a winter's morning. Yes, it's just not so much winter anymore. It's spring. Second of spring. I have my blankie on. Would you, Rondo, look at my spanky new shorts. Have you seen them? You seen them? Aren't they lovely? They're green. You see that because I'm in the bush.
Quite a fashionista.
Yes, I am a fashionista. Indeed. But yes, the apricity I am enjoying. It's not very cold. Ah, Michael, quite a nice question from you about how you say sunrise in Shangaan. Well, quite interestingly, a province called Mpumalanga, which means from whence the sun doth come. Well, not quite like that, but yes. Mpuma is to come from, Ilanga, sun. Now that's in the language of Ndebele or Zulu, it's the same. Mpumalanga. So what you would say in Shangaan is Rihuma Jambo. So Guhuma means to come from, Jambo, sun. So Guhuma Jambo is the sunrise. And that would be, I think, Huma, Huma, and Jambo, Jambo, which of course, genre in Swahili, where I have just been, is hello, correct. Jambo, Jambo. Right, here we go, off-road, see if we can find the Leuven. Well, it's pretty easy driving to start with, which may then result in some fairly heavy off-road driving, but we hope not. So while we do this, let's go across to Jamie for the morning surprise.
You're going to go off-road as well, but not terribly far. Just have a look at what we've just found. Well, that Herbert has just found. Perched up in the top of the tree, and I'm staying far for now just to show you what we've got. How absolutely wonderful. Isn't that a glorious image? Leopard up in the tree, feeding away on her impala kill. We don't know who it is just yet. It could be Shadow. It could also be Karula. Let's go and investigate. Awesome. Well done, Herbert. Thank you very much. Everybody give Herbert a round of applause, but very softly, because we don't want to scare the leopard that's up in the tree. Magic. I bet you Herbert's got that big grin all over his face. Let's see if he's got it. Oh, it looks so pensive. There we go. Well done, Herbert. Okay, let's just have a quick look. He thinks it's Shadow. She's done an impressive job, if it is Shadow, getting that impala up that tree. Let's go and investigate a little closer. I'm just trying to figure out a good route here, without making too much noise. All right. Toby's telling me he must go around, but I want to stay this side because of the sun. What do you think, Brian? I think so too. We won't make her feel trapped. We'll just stop here. Thanks, Herbert. We're going to stay here just because of the sun.
Okay, copy.
I'm just going to let Herbert move away so that we don't make the leopard feel as though she's trapped with two vehicles on either side of her. So we'll stop here for now and just examine the scene in front of us. Who have we got here? Give us a look at your face, please. So it could be for new viewers. I mean, this is just the most perfect way if you're starting out watching these live safari drives. What a perfect way to start off a morning with a leopard up a tree with a freshly dead impala kill. The question is, which leopard is it? It is most definitely a female, just judging by her size. It could be most likely one of two leopards. One is Karula, the other is Shadow. My suspicion is that it's Karula. I've never seen Shadow being able to hoist an impala kill of this size up into a tree straight away. If she does hoist something, it's usually small. And it is usually after she's fed on it for a little bit. This is very, very fresh. Come on, girl. Have a quick look at us in this direction. There we go. It's Karula. Yeah. Yeah. Yes. Thanks, Herbert. There we go. We have confirmation. It is indeed the queen herself with her beautiful face. Queen Karula. And that makes much more sense because I was going to be very, very impressed if Shadow had managed to do that. Karula, with all her power, is an exceptional leopard. I'm still really, really impressed with her that she managed to get that impala up that tree. It's a very tall tree. Imagine doing that. You know, that impala probably weighs the same she does, if not a little bit more. And she's taken it up the tree with her teeth and her claws. And lovely to have you on board, Katie, watching in the UK. It is fantastic always to hear from our newer viewers. Now, Katie has a question about the leopards of the Kruger National Park area, or the greater Kruger National Park area, and whether or not impala is their main prey. Katie, it depends upon the size of the leopard and the sex of the leopard. So generally with the females, like Karula, they target the impala and then smaller antelope like steenbok and dacre. So you'll probably find that it's somewhere in the region of 40 to 50% of their diet is impala, whereas the rest is made up of smaller things. With males, slightly larger, slightly stronger, you'll probably find a higher percentage is of their diet is made up of impala or slightly bigger things. Look at the way she's using her tail to balance herself there in a very, very tricky position. And Katie, the other thing is it's also seasonally dependent. So at a time when the impala are rutting, then the leopards have a fantastic time. So that's their breeding season, and the male impala are particularly distracted during that period of time. And what that means is that they're not as alert as they might otherwise be, and the leopards make a killing from, so to speak, of the various males that are not as focused as they should be. And then once we get to November, December time, which is when the females start to drop their lambs, they are either hugely heavily pregnant or they've got little stumbling babies with them, and then the percentage of a leopard diet that is impala-based goes up again. So it does just depend upon the time of year. And as we go into this drought, or we continue into this drought that South Africa's been experiencing, our predators are loving life. And Safari Hayes has asked the question that is, of course, on everybody's lips, which is, where are the cubs? So Karula, the queen of Juma, has two gorgeous It is the second. They are 7 months old today. Two gorgeous little cubs, a male and a female. I haven't seen them in about a month, and I'm sure she's hidden them somewhere safe. So what she's probably going to do, she's probably going to munch away on her impala kill and then jump down once she's eaten a little bit and go and fetch her gorgeous little ones. And just imagine the scene that we are in for as the little cubs start to struggle their way up into this marula tree to feed off their breakfast. While we wait and see what Queen Karula decides to do and where she decides to go, it is once again a big cat themed drive. Let's jump on board with James and some gorgeous lions.
The little baby lion going towards the meaty kill where the lionesses have started to feed again on what can only be described as a rotten breakfast. It is very smelly where we're sitting here. I think that is on account of the fact that the lions have relieved themselves at various places around where they're eating, and still they will fight over their food. It is amazing to me.
On account of your driving through
the people. Jean-Ré, be quiet and make film. This is very sweet. Isn't that amazing? That's quite lucky, and obviously very skilled from Jean-Ré's point of view, because I actually can't see that with my naked eye. I'm watching on the monitor here. That really is very sweet indeed. Hello, James Richard. You're wondering if the lions here have the same sort of survival rate as they do in the Mara. James, I think, yes, they probably do have roughly the same survival rate. It's quite interesting. We're trying to do some research on the lions there, and I think I read something yesterday that said there were 60 lions, plus minus 60 adults, in the Mara. It's roughly the same size as the area here. Now, I would have said that there are... Yeah, it's probably about the same, you know. It might be slightly fewer lions there than there are here. Whether the survival rate of the cubs is different, I'm not really sure. You might find that it's slightly worse there because the number of hyenas is that much greater. There are definitely more hyenas, so the chances of there being difficult conflict between lions and hyenas that much higher. Now, what I'm going to try and do is just move slightly to give Jean-Ré a better angle. There are also some cubs in there. Now, Roger, you want to know if there are any hyena nearby. Roger, hyenas are very scarce here at the moment. I'm really not sure why. There certainly used to be far more around. Maybe it's because the Ninkahumas have been spending so much more time here, and it's wonderful that they have. And we're certainly not going to begrudge their presence here, even at the expense of our hyenas for the next little while. But I haven't seen much in the way of hyena activity for some time. Jean-Ré, will you let me know if you get a shot? I don't think it's going to be great. He You can do something there, can you? So you'd like me to stop with my head in this bush? Emma, nice question from you. Do I think that the Birmingham boys will get mange from the Styx Pride and pass it on to the Nkuhumas? There are a few things about that question that are interesting. Firstly, we don't know that the Styx have got mange. I'm not sure what disease that is. I'm certainly not qualified to say. It might just be an eczema. It might be mange, but it might be something less serious. So I don't know. Secondly, whatever they do have, I wonder if they didn't get from the Birminghams. Remember that one Birmingham boy had that dreadful skin infection on, went all the way down his belly at one stage. And so I'm not sure that they didn't actually pick it up from the Birmingham boys. And the fact that they have not been eating in the same way that these chaps have, I think has brought about a weakness. And you know that when you're weak, of course, and your body is compromised, you're not eating properly, the chances of getting sick are that much higher. And I'm just wondering if they haven't got slightly ill because of the fact that they haven't had anything like the meal and nutrition that the Nkuhumas have. And I wonder if that isn't what's going on there. So that would be my guess. It might be entirely wrong, and that's the joy of what we do here. Of course, you can postulate and guess, and you're proved right or wrong depending on how things pan out. Well, that's what I'd say. I think everyone's moving towards the kill here, which is rather exciting. Even the little teddy bear cubs. Now, Jamie and I were discussing yesterday the sexes of the cubs. She reckons, and I agree with her, that the three youngest, two males and one female, and the other three, so the oldest ones, two females, one male, and the middle two, quite possibly two females. So that's the guess at the moment, but as we were saying yesterday, they don't sit still for any length of time, and so it's quite difficult to figure out exactly what sexes they are. All right, let's head back across to Jamie and the great Queen. She, of course, not Jamie, the Queen is having breakfast. I don't think Jamie's having breakfast, and I doubt she's sharing whatever she's eating with Karula.
I haven't been brave enough to ask Karula if I could share her hard-fought-for and won impala kill. Just look at this incredible view that we have managed to find ourselves. It doesn't get better than this. The magnificent and very dainty Queen of Juma has just had a small choke. I think something, part of the impala went down the wrong pipe, but she seems to have managed to right herself after a couple of gentle wheezes. Don't worry, Karula, I know the feeling at the moment. She's still looking a bit uncomfortable. She keeps casting off, looking to the south of where we are now, and I'm sure that's where her cubs are. And she's torn between going to fetch them and filling her stomach with a little bit more impala. And I'm almost certain that when she does climb down this tree and go and fetch those cubs, she's going to come in this direction. Marianne in Arkansas is thinking along the same lines. Funnily enough, Marianne, Brian and I just had exactly that conversation, that without the lower limbs of this incredibly tall marula tree in which we find Karula, watching her hoist the impala would have been absolutely magnificent. I wonder if she managed it the first time round, or if there were a couple of oopsies before she got right up there. We've seen Tingana drop a few things and fall out of a few trees. Karula, I don't know, there's just something so incredibly competent about her in all aspects of her life. She probably did it perfectly in one go. But it is a tremendously impressive feat. I mean, she must be, what is that? 10 meters? 12 meters up in the air? Probably even higher. It is an enormous tree. I would have absolutely loved to have seen her drag that impala carcass up there. And this is what makes leopards so incredible. Pound for pound, they must be one of the strongest animals that we get out here. To be able to lift their body weight up into a tree is just astounding. You can see she's eaten most of the rump. Sorry for those of you who are a bit queasy or a bit sensitive of stomach, because this is a fraction gory. She's eaten away most of the rump. I don't think she's even pulled out the stomach contents. Perhaps a hyena was lurking and she had to do this in a hurry. Either way, she's done an amazing job. Now she's using her rasping tongue with the backwards facing spurs, just like your house cats, to find a good way of going about eating this impala, getting rid of the fur before tucking in properly. Well done, girl. Just letting us soak in this incredible imagery for a moment. It's safe to say wow at that point. We've just had the most incredible. Oh, there she goes. Is she gonna go and fetch the cubs now? Oh, oopsie. A tricky spot. My goodness, look at the agility. Mr. Henry could take some lessons from Karula in the tree. So could Brent, of course. Both of whom have shown a certain lack of grace in their tree climbing endeavors. Oh, I'm just going to casually stop here on this branch with gravity against me and clean my paws. Can't think of a better spot. Fastidious as always, she's cleaning the residual blood off her face. And Blue Butterfrog, in terms of her kill and what remains of it, I don't actually think she did remove the stomach contents, which is relatively unusual. Usually when a leopard makes a kill, and lions as well, but very often with a leopard, they pull out the stomach contents, the indigestible intestines and stomach that have no nutritional value for them and actually just get a bit smelly. They remove them and then they drag the carcass away from them. Now, as far as I can see, she's only opened up the rump of the impala and eaten from that area. I don't think she's actually taken out the intestines and the stomach contents. Well, the steenbok or a dacre or a small kill, the leopard will actually just eat everything, including those stomach contents. They're not too picky. But I'm surprised that she hasn't, and it sort of is what led me to believe that she might have done this in haste. I also say that because as I drove in, I noticed some very, very fresh looking hyena tracks around this area, and I wouldn't be surprised if while we're sitting here there isn't one lurking, lying up somewhere, patiently waiting for its chance to pick at the scraps. Making sure she gets all of the tree bark and meat and fur out of those all-important claw sheaths so that her claws don't build up any muck and then get stuck when they retract. She's like, in a way, like a soldier, making sure that her weapons are clean and functional. I'm with you, Michael. I cannot wait. On the one hand, I'm scared she's going to disappear south of our boundary. On the other hand, she's got a fresh impala kill in a tree. She's going to bring the cubs back here at some point. And Michael's thinking along the same lines, just how extraordinary it's going to be watching Hosanna and Shungile, who are two little cubs, attempting to negotiate a particularly tricky spot. But of course, at 7 months old, they are much more coordinated than they were when they were little tiny bundles of fluff tumbling out of tree branches. I remember Brian and myself having the most incredible sighting with them when they were just a few months old, falling out of trees. That was terribly cute. Remember that, Brian?
I do.
When she nipped him on the stomach.
Yeah.
So cute. I can't wait to see them. I haven't seen them in ages. But we'll let the queen have a chance to rest for a moment. give herself a jolly good clean before she goes down. She is going to jump down as soon as she's finished her morning ablutions. I would say that with almost certainty she's going to climb down and go and fetch those cubs. And I don't know how far away they may be. I strongly suspect they're outside of our traverse area, because Herbert didn't find any cub tracks coming across. But you never know. Hello, gorgeous. We will come straight back across to Karula as soon as she starts to move. But for now, as I said, a predator-rich sunrise safari. Let's jump back on board and go and have a look at those delectable little monsters with James.
I think it's very unfair that Jamie describes me as a monster. But I suppose I am quite delectable, aren't I, Jandre? I don't think she was referring to me, do you?
Definitely.
No, possibly these lions. Now, they're all up at the kill. They're all shouting at each other and trying to find bits and pieces for themselves to eat. The cubs are fighting over the milk. The mothers have interestingly been fighting over the kill despite the fact that they've been feeding on it now for 3 days. They still fight. If they get in each other's ways, these throaty growls explode forth from them, and it really is quite a bone-chilling sound. I must just tell you, the smell here is something else. It is truly vile. And with any luck, Karula will come and fetch her babies and bring them. Let's just listen to these amazing lions now once Tax has left. Ooh, they look like they're all coming this way now. They're with that lioness that you're looking at. With a little one, John, I don't know if you can get it, but it's sharpening its claws on that tamboti tree. Look, I think they're going to go back into the open. I hope they are. Hello, Tingana the leopard. What a very good Twitter handle that is. You say, how many lionesses are there at the kill site here? Tingana the leopard, there are 5 lionesses at the kill site. Now what she's doing, she's growling a bit at the youngster. She's growling at the youngster. There. They're right next to us now. These are the little teddy bears, the 3 youngsters. Alright, quickly let's go across to Karula. Apparently she's thinking about coming down the tree.
Perfect timing as the queen makes her dainty descent. Oh, look at that. Oops, sort of dainty descent. Sorry, shouldn't laugh. I couldn't do that. And there she goes. And now it is time for her to go and fetch the royal duo, I imagine. Although she's kind of torn. Breakfast, kids, can't quite decide. Maybe a rest in the shade, quick sniff around the base of the tree. Somebody doesn't seem to be in any rush to spoil her kids-free moment. Oh, there we go, blue butter frog. I was wrong. She did remove the stomach contents. She's covering it now. Yes, it's still there, girl. Don't worry. Okay, she did definitely remove the stomach contents. Doing the typical cat thing of covering it up to hide the scent. Clever girl. She knows she's got to leave the carcass behind and go and fetch the cubs, so she's doing her utmost to make sure that it is still here when she returns. I think you got it, Kula. Yeah. Preparation for the morning ablutions, or continuation of the morning ablutions, let's put it that way. She's going to cover that up as well. Really hope she brings the cubs in this direction. Fair enough. She has just had a serious meal very quickly. Again, making sure that she covers up all of her waste so as not to attract unwanted attention. You can still see the little bit of blood around her neck from where she's been feeding. She obviously had her head right in that carcass. And here she comes. Oh, this feeling never gets old.
Yeah, morning,
she walks right past the vehicle. And off the queen goes to go and fetch the prince and princess. I'm not going to follow her all the way through. I'm going to go relocate her on Gowrie Main rather than trying to get through this very thick area, just because I know exactly where she's going to return to. While we loop around and catch her on the other side, let's go back to James and those lovely lions.
Isn't this sweet, everybody? We've just had quite a nice interaction here. Then I moved a little bit forward and slightly disturbed them, so they got up again and decided, Mum decided she was actually a bit hungry for some rotting buffalo. Jandre, just to your left. So sweet. Look. So I'm 99% sure that of the three little ones, very little, the teddy bear ones, we've got two males and one female. The others I really haven't seen properly. I'm going to roll back, Chandri. Would that help, or should you think it's going to make any difference? There's quite a lot of bush here, everybody, as you can see. I'll just do that. Does that help you? I think, I wonder if the male isn't coming in. Why? There is a male here, everybody, but he was so flat and under bushes that I didn't even bother to try and get a picture of him for you. But you see they keep looking behind there. And he might think about coming for something to eat. They will be absolutely aware of him. Very careful. Even though he probably doesn't pose a harm to these or a threat to these cubs, he will be very careful. And I think this kill is just about done for them. It wouldn't surprise me if we didn't find them here this afternoon if they had moved on. Thank you. Now a question from a new viewer with an astounding Twitter handle, the Snapple Attack. Snapple Attack, you want to know how long this kill has been here? As far as I understand it, they killed this buffalo 2 nights ago, so they're on to the 3rd day. No. See two lionesses moving off. But there's still some eating going on. Let's see what the cubs do. It will not be easy to follow them if they go into this stuff, everybody. In fact, it will be nigh on impossible. Excuse me. Now, even though they're so full, they've been stuffing themselves for 3 days. They're having a fight. The cubs are all going away now. Hello, Tinky in Canada. You want to know how many teats a lion has? They've got 4, Tinky. 4 inguinal mammy, as they say. Batelier. How cool is that? That was very fast, Chandra. That'll be your only compliment of the week. Hello, Upzul, is it? Upzul, you say we see the birds sort of flying around. Oh, Upzul. You see we see the birds flying around to the kills, but we don't ever see them really finishing kills. And you want to know why. Upzul, excuse me. Upzul, I think it's because vultures here are a semi-endangered species, to be honest. I think, well, not many species, 5 species of vulture we get here. I think they're in quite serious trouble. 10 years ago, 15 years ago, when I started out here, you would come to a kill like this and there'd be vultures in the trees, and as soon as the lions looked like moving off, the vultures would descend. It just doesn't happen anymore. And I read an article yesterday of 120 vultures killed at one poison carcass. And so I think the poaching of vultures and their sale in traditional medicine is making a real, having a really damaging effect on the population numbers of vultures out here. They are here, they're around, they're not completely absent by any stretch, but I think that's one of the major reasons we don't see them on the ground as much here as we used to. Now I can see the cubs, but Jandre can't. So what I'm going to do is just move slightly forward to show you where they've gone, most of them. There are a few left here. Am I good to move, Jandre? Mm-hmm. Well, that's quite a nice picture you've got there, which I think I'll probably ruin. Well, let me try. Can you see them there? They're the other side of the... No visual. Maybe slightly further forward. You should have them now. Across the way. If you just zoom in there.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just to show you where they've gone. There we are. Well spotted. And I just don't think that we can get a better view of them than that, I'm afraid. Not ideal, is it, Jandre?
No.
No.
You could roll back to see the carcass.
Okay. There you go. Now, Linda, very nice question from you. We've discovered that there are at least 3 male lions here at this carcass, and you want to know, will they stay together when they grow up? It's highly likely that they will. And this is quite a nice thing to see, because we've got males from different litters here, from 2 different litters, 3 males. And you want to know if they'll stick together. Well, yes, they will. And they'll turn out like the Birmingham boys, for example. And if perhaps there are more males born fairly soon, they might join in with that coalition. And so what's interesting is that we refer to the Birmingham boys as kind of brothers, but it's quite possible that they're not siblings, that they're cousins. And that, I think, is mostly the case in these male coalitions. And if we look at the Matimbas, certainly they looked very different to each other. They're two Batalier there now. Very nice. And the Matimbas look totally different from each other, so I don't think that they were littermates. I think they were probably cousins. So let's pretend that Amber Eyes gets pregnant fairly soon, which is not unlikely given that she has been mating and she's been an estrus. She has male cubs. They will be at least sort of, well, 3 months younger than the youngest male here. And by the time they're sort of 7 or 8 years old, you won't even notice that. But when they eventually have to leave the pride, at say 2.5 to 3 years, you will notice a slight difference in their size, and they could probably look different from each other. You can see what they want, the birds. You see that sinew in between the ribs there. They'll be looking forward to getting at that, especially something like a Batalier with a small sharp beak. The hooded vultures the same, and then the white-backed vultures, they'll get into the bigger stuff. Oh, it's amazing to watch. Friday morning genre. Yeah. Friday morning work.
Tough life.
It's a tough life. That's a lovely one of there, her eye through the gap there. That is a very large piece of femur that she's biting on there. The femur, of course, slightly truncated on a buffalo. It's not very long like it is with us. And you can hear that crunching of the carnassials slicing the meat off the skin, slicing it off the bone. And carnassials, for those of you who don't know, the molars on an animal like this, and if you are perhaps a new viewer and you want to know what a carnassial tooth is, and you have a domestic animal, be it a cat or a dog with you, won't work if you keep chickens or goats, but grab your cat or your dog, assuming that it is not a particularly vicious animal, pull its lips back, not the front teeth, but go to the back of the teeth, and then try and cajole it into opening its mouth, and then watch how then you can let it close its mouth again, and watch how the back teeth close over each other, but not in the same way that yours and mine do, on top of each other, but to the side, and so they form a cutting surface. And if you've got a particularly old dog or cat, it's probably easier with a compliant dog than it is with a cat, what you will find is that the teeth have actually occluded against each other and become sharper. They form a very effective cutting edge. See, now there are birds coming in, hooded vulture flying in. And sitting with the Batalier. Oh, that's wonderful. And the lioness not pleased about that development. And they have to watch the vultures, and they will be careful of the vultures, because of course, if there are strange males in the area, if there is a male in the area, if they want to keep their kill from the males, which almost always they do want to, they know that the males will follow vultures, because they are the ultimate scavengers out here. Likewise, hyenas could easily follow them into this kill and pose a threat to them and to their little cubbies. I'm hearing a little bit of movement behind me. I wonder if the male isn't up. No, I don't see him. I'm hoping that he'll come in here, because I think it will be rather fun to see him coming. There's Amber Eyes. Look where she's going. I wonder if not to seek the male out. We think she's an estrus. We've been asked a number of times, is Amber Eyes the dominant lioness in this pride? We don't really have a situation of dominance with lionesses in a pride. But she is often up and about before the others, looking around. I think we think she's dominant just because she looks different, you know. She's not bigger. She's not the oldest. But she does seem to be fairly effective at getting up and looking around and seeing what's going on. Another female up here as well, Gendre. She's kind of, oh, she's now turned around again. But she was looking in that direction. That one there that's now on the left-hand side of your picture. Hello, Natasha in Ontario. You're wondering what the oldest carcass is that a lion can eat. Natasha, I suspect that a lion would happily eat a fossil if it could, and they really don't give a flying what's it. How rotten and disgusting a piece of meat is, they will eat it. So if a fossil were to retain some sort of smell, well, I think they'd eat that too. I'm obviously being completely facetious because a fossil wouldn't smell. But they will eat anything, Natasha. If they can, obviously they will eat sort of meat like this rather than bone. And so if there is an animal with some flesh left on it, it cannot be too old for them to eat. There we go, that's that rib sinew going now. The hooded vulture will be looking down with a great jealousy. Just listening to Texan. Ah, he says there's a male lion moving up Twin Dams Road towards this area. That's quite far from here still. It's not close by, but that is interesting. And that is precisely what these lions will want to avoid. So when the vultures start wheeling above this kill, and the fact that there are two battalier and one hooded vulture here tells you that the other vultures, when they start to fly, which will probably be a little bit later than now, as the heat starts to build, they will see these two birds here and they'll come down here, and that male lion, you can be very sure, will pick them up and he'll watch where they come down. And he may well then come to investigate. And what that means for the females, of course, is that their breakfast will be stolen. Their lunch will be stolen. The male will feed first. He'll box them off this kill until he's eaten his fill. You notice how that rhymed, Gendre?
No.
I'll say it again for you, just in case you missed it, because you are from Cape Town, so your brain is very slow. He will box them off this kill. I've forgotten... I've forgotten what I said there. That's called karma, isn't it? Yeah. Yes, karma. Okay, let's go back to the lions. I'm so ashamed. I've got it now. He will box them off this kill. Until he eats his fill. It's like... Hello, Dave in Toronto. You want to know about the difference in male ages in a coalition and what's the biggest I've seen? I think the biggest I've seen is about 3 years, you know. They can meet up with complete strangers. And we know the junior ex of the Nkuhuma pride, chased from these lands by the Birminghams, hooked up with a much younger male than him, probably about a year to a year and a half younger than him. I've seen lions sort of 3 years apart forming a coalition, so that's not too unusual, Dave. And it's quite nice to see. It looks like a sort of older boy with a mentor, or a young chap with a mentor. It's quite a nice thing to see, rather than this kind of formidable gang, which the Birmingham boys unquestionably are. And Laurie, you're wondering how long these little male cubs will enjoy the comfort and joys of home before eventually their dads say, "That's enough, chap. Off you go and find your way in the world." The answer is about 2.5 to 3 years normally is when they'll get tossed out, because round about then they become sexually mature and then they start to mate with the other pride members. And the males will not tolerate that, and they'll toss them out fairly swiftly thereafter. And so, yeah, 2.5 to 3 years. Junior lasted a bit longer, I think, because of the upheavals here between the Matimbas and the Birmingham Boys. The Matimbas, for those of you who don't know, they were the coalition of two that held territory in this area before the Birmingham Boys came in to usurp them. And he lasted a bit longer because of that takeover, I think. But normally, I don't think these males would last more than 2.5 to 3 years here. Very nice. That's a very cool shot. All right, I believe that Jamie Patterson is having a little bit of a rough time with Karula. So let's go and find out what the great Royal Queen has done to Jamie.
The great Royal Queen has saddened me greatly. No, not really. She's gone to fetch her cubs, and that means she's crossed south over our traverse area and out the other side, which is what we expected her to do. She crossed a little bit further away than we expected, and there were some other vehicles there. So we've left the sighting, we've left her for now, and we're going to go and follow up on an interesting report not far away from where we left Karula and her kill. And that is the fact that Andries tells me there are mating leopards somewhere in this vicinity. Could it be Tingana and Shadow? Or who else could it be? We're going to go and investigate and see. And hopefully they don't decide to come and nick Karula's kill while she's away fetching her cubs. We've got some lovely ellies. This will provide us with a nice point to just sit and listen. As you know, a mating leopard pair is not a subtle thing. And these ellies are a bit upset. I think that's why. So we're just going to wait, everybody. Karula will bring her cubs back to us and we'll have them all to ourselves. I do just want to hop onto the Game Drive channel quickly and just chat to Tax. Hey guys, where are those leopards? Lovely. Okay, let's just sit here for a moment and listen for the sounds of the mating leopards. Just bear with me one second. I'm sort of dealing with two different radio channels here, so I have to chat to two different people in two different places. Tax. Station's just an update on Karula. She's crossed into Little Gowri. Apparently the Pimpons are quite far into Hoffman's, so she might be a while, but I'll keep you updated. Okay. A lovely morning. Beautiful scenes of Karula and now lovely scenes of elephants as they munch away. I said that they were a little unsettled, and that is true. They were not comfortable at all when I drove past them earlier to see if I could follow up on Karula. Oh, let's go look at the little baby. Sorry. There's a little baby just ahead of us. Hi, guys. Here we go. No little one. And while we sit here and enjoy the peace that is an elephant sighting, we're also listening for that brrrr sound. That was not the best impression ever. But I never claimed to be a fantastic animal imitator. But that's what we're listening for, so you can all help us listen out for that particular sound. One. Baby elephants are utterly adorable with their tiny little ears. and those uncoordinated trunks. Back once again munching on spike thorns. It's definitely not what you want, hiding behind Mum. It's a little boy. Come say hello, little one. And Felicity, lovely to have you on board. And we've had so many things happening this morning that the start of the sunrise safari feels like ages ago. It feels like a different day already. But Felicity said, well, earlier this morning I was talking about the relief of the animals at dawn, or the diurnal animals at dawn. And do they not have very good night vision? They do have very good night vision. Or certainly better than ours. It's not as good as the predators, but it is better than ours. And I merely said, I don't know if that's true. It's just something that I imagine it must feel like a bit of a relief, because the night, of course, is when the large nocturnal predators are out and about and far more active. And I'm sure intrinsically or instinctively, the... That's elephants, that is not leopards. Sorry, just sitting listening. I'm sure instinctively the animals know that, the diurnal animals know that. There's a reason why, as human beings, when we start to feel a little bit unsettled as the sun starts to go down, that desire to go home, I know Brent always talks about this, that desire to go home and get somewhere safe is something intrinsic from a time when we would also have been moving about just like the diurnal animals that we have out here, and we pray for something else. Unfortunately, for those of you who are noticing the weird crackling and funny sounds that are coming from my microphone, there's absolutely nothing I can do short of what I did yesterday, which was gaffer taping it to my body, which I don't think I'm going to do right now. I think I'm going to avoid doing that, as I still have red welts from yesterday, which was the last time I did it. We've tried to secure it as much as possible, and hopefully it decides to stick, but sorry everybody, we're just having some gremlins attacking our microphone. Hello. And the Snapple Attack, a warm welcome. I haven't heard your username before, so it's fantastic to have another new viewer on board with us. Our Snapple Attack would like to know if an elephant has ever tried to charge me when her little one decided to get too close. I have been charged by elephants before, and I have been warned by females before to just mind my own business and to not in any way be a threat to their little ones. But I've never had... It's very important that you don't put yourself in that position where you've become a threat to a female and her baby. Now just bear with me one second. I'll continue that conversation in one moment. I just want to have a quick chat to Tax. Who's coming through. I've been trying to... Oh, no, I'm not going to move right now. And while I chat to Tex, let's go across to James and his lions.
Now, this lioness is not happy, everybody, and I mentioned to you the fact that the males made them uncomfortable. The male has got up behind us, and he's making his way here. He could easily decide to go back to sleep somewhere close to where he is now, but that's why she's up. Two lionesses are between him and her, and they are sleeping in the morning sun now. I don't know what he's going to do. I can see him. You can't see him because there just isn't a shot. I can just sort of see him. He stopped, and he seems to be smelling something. Well, there's lots to smell around here, isn't there, Jean-André? Jean-André can now see him coming. The Birmingham boy. It's a lovely shot there, Jean-André. Beautifully framed by the car. I don't want to move, everyone, because if he does come into the kill, I think we're going to be in the prime position, but I wonder if he isn't... Yes, going to say hello to the ladies first. No, he's not even going to do that. He's going down into the sort of erosion gully there. He's a big fellow, that. They really are the gangsters of the wild. I know we tend to think of them as the royalty, but these chaps, I think, very much mirror the human. They don't mirror human royalty so much as they do human gangsters. No honour amongst thieves there. Not that there's often much honour amongst royalty either, but... Yeah, he's smelling. What he's doing is he's testing the patches of urine around here. And that sounds fairly disgusting. But that's what he's doing. Hello, Lisa. You want to know, once these males are forced out of this area, what name do I think the new coalition of males will have? Lisa? I don't know. I don't think we know. You know, these males come from a farm called Birmingham, and that's why they called the Birmingham Boys. I think they were named by Hayden Turner, actually. It was a very clever name, because the Birmingham Boys were, in fact, a group of gangsters, as far as I'm aware, from the town of Birmingham, where Emily Wallington comes from. And that's not to say that Emily Wallington is a gangster, but that is where she is from. And so the Birmingham Boys were a very appropriate name, because they are like a little gangster bunch, and they come from the farm Birmingham. So the new coalition that comes in here, I mean, who knows what they could be known as? The West Side Boys, perhaps? Al Capone and the Rollers? Oh, I see. And maybe you probably mean when these cubs leave, what will they be known as? Yeah, they could easily be known as the Juma Boys. Who knows? You see, they won't, when they do leave here, they won't stay here. And so wherever they pitch up, wherever they eventually come to dominate, let's hope that that does happen, then you will find that wherever that place is, they'll get a name from there. Jandra, I'm going to go back. Let's make the call to go back and have a nice look there. Dark tranquility. You want to know if male lions ever take over the pride into which they were born and end up mating with their mothers and sisters. It does happen from time to time. It's unusual, but if, for example, the Birmingham Boys were very old, which they are not, if they were very old, then it is quite possible that what would happen is that a litter of young males could become the dominant males in the area, and then they would mate with their sisters. And it is slightly a Games of Thrones-ish, or Game of Thrones-ish, if you like, the Lannisters. But it does happen, but there's no harm to it. There's no harm to it at all. Six generations, apparently, the cats can cope with. Ooh. Now, what he's doing, the male there, is Flemin grimacing, of course, which many of you have heard of. Is this all right, Jandre? We're just making such a horrible noise that I thought we should stop. And he's testing the urine to see if any of these females are ready to mate. Now, look on his right shoulder there. That's a cub. That's a cub shouting, everyone, at the kill. He's not very happy, is he, Jandre? Indeed, he could be considered cross. That was a little cub. Very angry. And there's a little breeze. Sorry, I was rudely interrupted there, of course, by the sound of a crested Franklin. Billy Joe, you want to know if there's a vulture that's large enough to pick up one of these cubs? Billy Joe, there isn't. The leopard-faced vulture is an enormous vulture, but the white-backed is not too small, both of which have been recorded killing their own prey. If they found a vulture on its, at least a cub on its own, they might think about killing it and then eating it, but they wouldn't be able to pick it up because leopard-faced and white-faced and white-backed and all the vultures don't have grasping talons. They don't have anything like the musculature that a leopard, or not a leopard, that an eagle has in its tarsals, and so they're unable to grab in the same way that an eagle can. That's quite nice there. I know this might bug you slightly. I'm just trying out a new camera to see if it'll work for various purposes that we have. But it does have a very loud shutter noise. Sounds like a crested Franklin calling. So I apologize in advance. Won't be forever. Do you hear that, Jandre?
The shutter.
The shutter, yes.
I think if you try the viewfinder...
Oh, you think so? Ah, what a nice question from somebody called Dark Lord Chinchin. Dark Lord Chinchin, you sound quite like a terrifying human being. You say, why is it that lions don't just mate every day? There's some trouble brewing here, everybody. Watch this. Why do they wait to smell urine? Or in the case of what's going on now, the back end of the male. Dark Lord Chinchin, it's largely because, it's actually quite a complicated discussion to have, but let's have it because I quite like it. Most mammals, Dark Lord Chinchin, unlike us, have what we call an obvious oestrus. So they don't mate unless the females are in oestrus. And in oestrus means in heat, basically, they're ready to mate, they're about to ovulate, and they can conceive when they mate. So if you think of dogs and cats, if you think of any of the antelope species that we get out here, elephants, they all give a sign to the males when they're ready to mate. That then inflames the males, and they will then mate. It's very unusual that you have what we call concealed oestrus. And the most obvious species that has concealed oestrus, Chandra, is the human being, correct. Human beings have got concealed oestrus, and the reason we think that that has happened in the evolutionary history of our species, and indeed of a few different primates, chimpanzees and bonobos being notable examples, is that by hiding oestrus, you keep a male close by. So in let's take us back to the cavemen, if you like. A woman that hides her oestrus period means that the male never knows when he is going to be able to impregnate her. And what that means is that you keep him around and he doesn't mate and just disappear. So in many of these species, like lions, for example, the male plays very little role in actual child rearing or support of the females. And so they have this hidden oestrus period, or not hidden oestrus, they have a very obvious oestrus period. Sorry, Jandre, that's going to burn my face off. If you don't mind, we can carry on back to the lions. And so in a long and roundabout way, Dark Lord Chinchin, the reason they don't have hidden oestrus is because it's set up like that, and they don't need to keep the male around for child-rearing purposes. The closer you get to the primates, the less that happens. And basically, all of this has got to do with avoiding infanticide. But that's a very long discussion. The cubs are now back at the kill, so I think we're going to move straight back there, if that's all right with everybody. All right, while we do that, Jamie's got some more elephants. So we'll try and reverse and not make too much noise. Go and have a look at the elephants.
All right, little girl, the Oh, there we go. We're busy talking about elephants charging us and whether we've ever been in a situation where an elephant isn't happy with our presence, particularly a female. And it is the females that you really need to watch out for, because they are the one that they are the most protective over their herd. In that case, a female gave us a little head shake there before moving off to join the rest of the herd. And it's just telling us to behave ourselves. Sorry, everybody. There's so much going on at the moment on the Game Drive comms. I just want to chat to Tax. Okay, copy. Is that Shadow?
Positive.
Okay, copy. Any sign of the Marauder?
So far, one of us.
Copy. Thanks, Tax. I'll make my way there in a moment. I'm going to go wait by that bumper.
Yeah, she's going west.
She's going west. Sorry, everybody. I mean, our elephants are absolutely lovely, but we've apparently arrived in Leopard Corner of Juma. I hear them. Okay. There's too much going on. I don't know what to do. I can hear mating leopards, and I know that Karula's on her way back with the cubs. Let's go to the mating leopard. Oh, goodness, there's so much choice here. I don't know what to do. And we've got elephants, of course, which are my absolute favourite to spend time with. But there's a good chance, because we're so close to our boundary, that the mating leopard... Okay, let's go. I can't stand it. I can hear them. Copy. I've got that audio. I'm going to make my way and join you. Oh, too much. I can't decide what to do. Tingana and Shadow are mating about 50 meters away from where we are. Karula is on her way back with her cubs. But what we're going to do is we're going to duck out of the sighting completely for now, because it is on a main road. There's going to be lots of people keen to see her, and we'll come back and rejoin the kill when they get there. So let's go across to Shadow and Tingana for now, and then we'll go back. There's just too much. Too much. We're spoiled. And while I go and track down Taxon and his mating leopards, let's jump on board with James.
That really is quite astounding, isn't it? Shadow and Tingana and Karula and all these lions. What an amazing morning we are having. And again, of course, the inevitable discussions about Shadow and her. You know, seemingly early estrus tie in quite nicely with what we were saying about the hidden estrus and the lack of hidden estrus amongst the cats. She is not mating for the sake of it. She is mating because she's come into estrus. She's had a very obvious hormonal change, and that has created a situation where she will ovulate if she mates. They don't ovulate before they mate, the lions and the leopards. It normally takes that very long process of mating for them to ovulate, and often they come into a sort of false estrus for a little while first, and then they go out of it, they mate a bit, and then they come back in. That certainly happened with Karula recently, and what's interesting with Shadow, I think, just listen to that. Here comes another female. What's interesting with Shadow is that she had that little fake estrus to start with. She has mated, she left Tingana, it's happening again now. We got to hope that for Zara's sake, that's her little cub, she holds off one more month. Because I think, if I'm not mistaken, she's 7 months old this month. Of course today, yes, actually exactly today, Karula's cubs are 8 months old. And in theory, sorry, who's older? I've forgotten who's older. February to March, April, May, June, July, August, September. 7 months. And Shadow's cub is 1 month younger, so she'll only be 6 months now. That makes sense. So the young Karula cubs are now 7 months old. And Shadow's cub will be... well, we can say that she's 6 months old now. So she needs another 2 months before she could possibly go independent. These things are screaming at each other, but we don't have a view, really, I'm afraid. They're having a huge fight. Hello, E.B. Murphy. I'm assuming you're meaning within a coalition. You say, is there any rhyme or reason as to who moves between which territory and who, you know, who stays with which pride? No, there isn't, I don't think. I think you'll find there's quite a lot of variation between who does what and when and how. You might find as they get more established, there's a slightly more stratified role, if you like. Certainly happened with the Matimbas. They were a coalition of four, and eventually they split, and the two came down. Ooh, that's vicious. Isn't that blood curdling? See, the cubs retreated when that happened. Now coming back covered in mud and blood. Now, I wonder if the cubs fighting hasn't precipitated that. Just like a human woman with a young child or a young family can get very ratty because their kids are fighting and messing around while they're trying to get on with serious business. So I think it is with the lions. Those cubs were starting to get very out of hand, fighting with each other, biting at their mothers. And eventually, I think that boiled over. And as far as I'm aware, what we have behind us is the male and Amber Eyes. And he's definitely keeping a very sharp eye on her. He obviously sensed something further in the urine that he found to smell. Glad we don't have to do that in the morning. But if you're a lion, that's your lot in life. And yes, you have to wander around smelling patches of urine. Okay, so let's go back to that discussion on whether or not their roles will change and stratify. Well, they will. Absolutely, over a little bit of time. But the best example is the Majingalan. The Matimba is actually a slightly odd example because they split completely. The Majingalan coalition, which dominates the western portions of the Sabi Sand, an area probably about twice the size of the area that the Birminghams have. They do split into two and two, but they very often will come together. And if there's trouble, they roar and they do come together and they support each other in a sort of fight. And that's been seen a number of times. So they do split up eventually and they'll do that sort of thing. So I don't know who's dominating up here and who's spending more time with the Styx Pride and who I think will eventually spend more time down in the south around Mala Mala. I think, you know, two prides for the two in the coalition is probably about right, and I think you'll find that eventually the Birminghams will dominate three or four prides if they manage to maintain the territory, because they're still not at their full size, it, you know. They've still got about a year and a half before they reach their full, sort of filled out size. Hello, Joey in Florida. You're wondering about the testosterone levels of male lions, and you say they're almost as high as a human being of 18 years old. I don't know if that's true, Joey. It's quite interesting. human testosterone levels, a fascinating subject, and I really couldn't tell you. I would suspect that a male lion's proportionately is quite a lot higher. They're that much more aggressive, and I would think, especially in the females, you'll find that they're definitely that much higher. Now, what we're going to think about here is I think Jamie's going to try and see Tingana and Shadow. If she is going to do that, I'm just going to ask Kirsty to confirm. It might be an idea for us to go back to the tree where Karula's kill is. So I think it might be a nice idea for us to go there and see if we can't see the Queen and Shongile and Hosanna. I haven't seen them, everybody, for at least 5 weeks now. So I'm feeling a great sense of FOMO, I suppose, fear of missing out on their growing up. So I think if Kirsten McLennan's Smithereens says it would be possible, I think we should head that way. Radio silence. Okay. I don't want to disturb Jamie, though, as well, if Jamie is going to go back to Karula because the mating leopards are being difficult, then we'll let her do that. So we've had rather the pick of things today. Sorry, Kirsty, go again with that. A big what there? Okay, I don't know what's going on, but I think Jamie is going to go back to Karula, so we'll stay here with these lions and see what pans out here. Coming back now, you see, after the little fight. And they're shouting at each other, trying to be brave, just cajoling each other. That's a lovely shot there. And now, again, they'll start to irritate the adults, and then the adults may well have another box at each other. Chandra, have you got consumption? Mike, a nice question from you. Obviously, the flies go onto the meat there, they lay their eggs, and the maggots hatch. And you want to know what happens when... Oh, that's very nice. What happens when the lions... Clearly, they must eat the eggs. Do they hatch in the intestine? No, I don't think so. I think you'll find that the eggs would be destroyed by the acidic stomach contents of the lions. I've no doubt there are various kinds of parasites internally that are able to cope with the acid digestion of a lion's stomach, but I think you'll find that something that has a life cycle ostensibly outside in the open air, I think what you'll find is that the maggots survive on the meat. Right, Jamie has not gone back to Karula. She is with Shadow and Tingana.
We're waiting for Karula to make her way back to the carcass, and we've been attracted by the sound of mating leopards. Karula has only just come back onto Juma. There are other vehicles with her, but hold on one moment, because in an exciting turn of affairs, right close to where Karula was, we've got Shadow and Tingana mating. It is a hugely difficult area for us to move about in. Where are they? There they are. Sleeping flat. I don't know if it's Shadow. I think it's Shadow. How's your... I know it's not going to be fantastic, but can you just see the spots through there? I'm going to move in a moment. Here's a leopard. The morning of leopards. Three different leopards, a lion pride on a kill. Possibly now, soon, five different leopards if we include Karula and her cubs. Let's try and get in here. The impenetrable thicket of gwari bushes and bush willows and tamboortis. And it's very important that we avoid driving over certain tree species, one of which is the tamboorti trees of this particular area. So we're going to do this really carefully. Hello, leopards. What a lovely surprise. What an amazing morning. Okay, what's going to be best? There's a big fallen log there, and there's a big fallen log there, and there's a big fallen log there. So all in all, it's going well. I think, actually, our best bet might be to do this. You ready for this, Bebop? You're excited? I'm excited too. This could be very interesting. Where is the other leopard? There she is. All right, everybody hold on to your hats. And other parts of you. As we go through the gwari thickets. This is interesting. I feel like an explorer moving through the jungle rather than the African savannah. How are you doing there, Brian? Me and my bright ideas. I don't know if it is shadow. Oh, she's gonna. There she is. How's your view? Not great. Those are the awesome sound effects that we've been looking for. Look at Tingana. Isn't he magnificent? And I think most of you are on the same page as I am, which is that we were all hoping that it wasn't shadow. And unfortunately, from that brief glimpse that I had there, I think it is. And we don't know for absolute certain that she has lost her little cub, the little female that we've seen only briefly over the last few months, just a month younger than Karula's two cubs. It is a very, very sad situation if she has. So that Shadow's done this before. She went into Estrus early with Sandile, where he was still a little bit young for her to be disappearing off for several days at a time. The problem is that he was a little bit older than Shadow's current cub, who at 6 months old is not going to have the same level of resilience. Sandile was able to provide for himself, catch little kills. It's going to be much, much harder for Shadow's female cub if she keeps disappearing like this. It might well be one of the reasons behind Shadow's inability, not inability, but lack of success in terms of raising cubs to adulthood, unlike her mother. You can see Tingana casting about. I wonder, Karula must know that they're here. She would have heard them, I can guarantee. As you heard there, it's not exactly a quiet experience, the whole mating process between leopards. This is actually quite a beautiful shot in its own way. We've been so spoiled today. Our leopard hidden behind the green leaves. Where are you going, Shadow? She's up. Is she going back towards the male? Yep, here we go again. Be the trickiest area. There is nothing quite like the spectacle that is leopards mating as the female does her dance of seduction around him. And as is usual with Tingana, he seems relatively, what would we say, not disinterested, but resigned, I think perhaps is the correct way to describe it. Listen to the sound she's making. Another brief but heated mating session, and with leopards even, even more so than lions. It is on such a regular basis, it's almost basically 2 minutes, every 2 minutes, particularly on a coolish morning like this morning before the temperature starts to go up and they're too tired to continue that way. I'm really hoping they decide to take this little adventure outside of this particular spot, because at the moment it's very, very difficult. We've just got flashes of spots in amongst the trees, which is beautiful in its own way, but definitely not the clearest view. Tax, tax. Sorry, everybody, just chatting quickly on the Game Drive channel. Is Karula back at that bumper?
Yeah, positive. She just arrived now.
Okay, copy, thanks. Yeah, I've got these two Ingwe, but it's a very difficult patch.
Yeah, not much of that. Lots of
And off she goes. We're going to try and stay with them for a little bit longer. If we manage to get them into a nice open position, then we will stick with them, and then James can head across towards where Karula is with Aubrey and Taxon. If they disappear, though, well, we're about 100 meters or so from where Karula has just returned to the kill. The reason that we're not there is that there are already two vehicles sitting with her. Oh my goodness, how do we do this? There is a very, very good chance that we could lose these leopards for now. In fact, that might have just happened. Okay, we'll try this side. So as I said, we're playing a very delicate game here. Not playing a delicate game, but we are being very, very careful as we move around here. So driving over the gwarri bushes, which are bush encroacher species, the ones that we've gone through here, that's fine. They are encroachers. There's lots of them, and they are very springy, as they've just demonstrated. The tamboertis, on the other hand, are trees that I'm going to be very, very careful, and I'll show you a tamboerti when I see one. So far, we're okay. And our leopard looks like she's moved out further into the open. Where's Tingana gone? Did they move through there? That's going to slap you, Brian. There you go. And while we negotiate around this tricky spot, I see you. Let's just switch off. She's coming towards. Oh, dearie me. Here we go again. Amazing sound effects. Micah was wondering, while she watches in Hawaii, how it is that the leopards make that interesting sound. Most of that's the sound effects there are from the male, and it's a very peculiar sound. You'll hear it with the male lions as well. It's almost a whining sound, and all of the fierce growling and roaring that make them sound like this is the most. Oh, she's still cross with him. And of course, the reason that she does that is because it's painful for her. So she turns around and reacts angrily at him. He's got a barbed penis, which is a way of inducing ovulation, making sure that she only ovulates and falls pregnant or doesn't waste an estrus cycle, essentially. So as a solitary animal, there's no guarantee that when a female leopard comes into estrus, she'll find a male. So by making sure that she only actually physically ovulates after mating, make sure that she doesn't waste any of her precious eggs. Also gives a chance for a bigger and better male to come along, although she'd be hard-pressed to find a better-looking male than Tingana.
Is any station with Karuna at this stage? Yeah, positive. Three of us here. Myself, Aubrey, and Ifran. Okay, copy. Can I go on standby one there? There's no rush text. Just keep me posted in the space there. And one of the journey will come in there. There's really no rush at all. Just keep me posted.
And off they go into the distance. Okay, it is going to be very difficult for us to follow them. At one point, we are going to have to give up. But we'll keep trying for now. Otherwise, we'll have a chance to head across. And oh my goodness, there's just so many things happening this morning. This is going to hurt. I don't think I really want to do this. No, I really don't want to do this, but I don't see any alternative. Put my sleeve up over it. Siberia Zumi makes a very good point. Once upon a time, shadow was actually known as Tingana, which means the shy one, before Tingana moved in as the dominant male of this area. So often what happens is, because leopards have their enormous areas that they move about in, often they move within different traverse areas, different lodges get to see them, and therefore they get different names. And Siberia Zumi is absolutely right. It is a mixture of Tingana and Tingana right now. Oh goodness, Shadow. You too. I will get us a good spot, I promise. To be able to witness scenes like this. Oh, very primal, with their teeth bared and their claws outstretched. Right, Tingana and Tingana, or Tingana and Shadow. What's going to be the best way to try and get round to you? Alright, well, it does seem as though, excuse me, James is going to be making his way towards that Karuna sighting. So we're going to try and stick with these guys. We're going to try and shift so we've got a more open view. You will have to wait a little bit, as there's quite a few vehicles wanting a chance to see those amazing scenes. But we do have exciting prospects for this. Oh, I say exciting prospects, we're already having exciting things happening. Gracious, okay. Now what? Let us. Can we go left, right, or back? Back is the answer. How are you doing then, Brian? Are you unscathed? Good. I'm thrilled to hear it. Our poor cameramen, of course, are the true heroes of sightings like this as they duck around the trees. I'm with James Richard on this. I'm hoping that Tingana, as James puts it, hasn't realized that Karula has breakfast ready and waiting for him. Since James is absolutely spot on, in that mating for leopards is very hungry work. And I'm sure that Karula would prefer to keep her kill to herself and her cubs. How's your view there, Brian? Let me go forward a bit. It's Shadow. It's definitely Shadow. That's definitely Shadow. Oh dear. Hey girl. It's not ideal. We're all keeping our fingers crossed that Shadows managed to keep her cub. The difficulty is, well, first of all, female leopards, when they lose their cub, come into oestrus almost straight away. It is a false oestrus, it's not a true oestrus, but it does happen almost immediately. But more worrying is that she's going to spend 5 days doing this. Some residual growling, like a sort of a Harley Davidson engine slowly turning over. Hey, gorgeous boy. Right. Okay, everybody. Grit your teeth and steel your nerves. We're going to reposition one last time, and hopefully this will be a successful moment. I think the best thing to do here, since we do have mating leopards, is for James to make his way towards Karula and the cubs. We'll have a chance this afternoon to go and see them. I just want to go see them. Been looking forward to watching them clamber that over that tree. All right, one more reposition. We have got some incredible scenes here. I can't believe I'm having to choose between a female leopard with cubs in a tree and mating leopards. It's ridiculous. This is starting to get ridiculous, Brian. Hello, girl. Bonk. Yeah, I think we'll send James back to Karula as deeply as that makes me want to sob softly into my sleeve, because I was really looking forward to seeing those cubs gambling up the tree. But we've got an extraordinary view that we just can't pass up, and there's no guarantee that we will find this pair again. They're very close to our boundary. So we will stick with them for now and wait for James to head to Karula. Well, one of the things that we've seen over the last few weeks has been the way in which aggressive incidents with the big cats escalate. I'm talking, of course, in terms of our lions and the scraps that they've had with the females and the males. But Jason is wondering if a leopard scuffle like this could escalate into a serious fight. It's very rare, but it can happen. So what sometimes happens with animals is they get, and people, I guess, it triggers that survival instinct, and they live so on the edge of their instincts that sometimes the instincts get a bit mixed up. It's one of the reasons why the Birmingham boys killed a couple of females when they first took over, with that testosterone-driven aggression that they were demonstrating, and was all part of their successful takeover. It spilled over into their interactions with other creatures as well, and it's possible to have that happen with leopards. I've never seen it in a major way. What sometimes happens, which we have seen happen before, is leopards get their dew claws, or their claws, stuck in the skin of each other. And then it escalates slightly, because now, for example, if the female's trapped or the male's trapped, they get very, very cross and uncomfortable. They blame the other leopard for it, and the other leopard gets defensive. So it's not uncommon to see leopards walk away from a mating session of about 5 days with cuts and rips and a bit of a limp maybe every now and again, and definitely looking ever so slightly the worse for the wear for their amorous encounters. No leopard comes out unscathed, certainly. And Mobile Paddy, who is quick to affirm that they are asking for a friend, Mobile Paddy, good morning and welcome to the Sunrise Safari, wants to know whether or not the male leopard ejaculates every time that he mates. There's a peak sort of period of ejaculation. So as you can imagine, the initial mating stages, when she's not ovulating, it would be a little bit of a waste of an important bodily resource for the male. So he only really ejaculates very tiny amounts, if at all, in the beginning. And then towards the middle, that starts to increase, because that, of course, is when the greatest chance of fertilization is going to occur. And then it sort of slowly peters out towards the end as his body has to keep replenishing his supply. Which, as you can imagine, if a leopard mates every couple of minutes, how many times have they mated while we've been here? Five, while Brian and I have been here? In the last 15, 20 minutes or so. It's roughly every 2 to 4 to 5 minutes, depending on the temperature of the day. You do the math. Okay, now I'll do the math. I was trying to avoid that, but I'll do the math quickly. Okay, let's roughly put it at, let's not exaggerate. Let's say they mate every 10 minutes. That's 6 times an hour. 6 times an hour, 6 times 24 is 120, 140 odd, 150 odd. I'm rounding up, okay? My mental maths at this time of the morning, just after holidays, isn't fantastic. So 150 times a day, times 5 days, you're looking at close to or over 500 mating sessions. And even if he only ejaculates out a little bit each time, it's quite an impressive impact that it has on his body. But as you may have noticed, when male leopards, or male cats actually, and dogs, they seem to have an replenishing supply of urine. If you've ever watched them go and spray and mark their territory, which I have to tell you is something I've always marveled at. I think it's quite impressive the way that they're able to continue to mark and urine spray bushes despite the fact that it's now the 20th bush in a row. I'm sure it's something similar, although a slightly lengthier process. Oh, they've exhausted each other. I know that James will be eagerly anticipating heading towards Karula. Let's find out how he is going on his journey.
Well, what a morning we've had. We've left those lionesses because they went into some very thick bush, and well, we thought about trying to get through the drainage line, see if we could see the cubs lying in the dappled shade of the Tambuti Grove, but unfortunately that was not possible because, well, we don't have a bulldozer. We have Rusty, and she's a temperamental old bag, she is. So we didn't do that, and we're now heading towards Karula because Jamie has found the mating leopards, and I was just saying to Jandre how I'm continually amazed at how we, as human beings, and I mean I'm exactly the same, no different here, but as human beings we rush when an animal is mating, we rush to go and look at it. We think it's the most fascinating thing, which it is. But of course, with human beings it's the most intimate and private thing that could ever happen. And so it's quite the opposite. And yet with any other animal, we have this absolute fascination. I think that's rather amusing. I'm exactly the same. Now, we're probably about, I would say, I don't know, no, nothing's very far away on Juma. We're probably about 5 or so minutes away from Karula. And we'll see what else we can see as we go. But you know, the heat has now started to build, and I was talking about the vultures a little bit earlier and how I don't think that there are that many around. And I look at the skies around me now and I see one or two every so often in the distance, but there isn't much going on in the way of vultures around here. And in the Mara, so much dies there, you know, there's so many animals there that many things just die of causes other than lion's teeth or cheetah's claws. And it means that there are little pockets of vultures all over. Everywhere you look, there are little pockets of vultures feeding on the ground or sitting in the trees. Not great big swathes of vultures like you get on some of the kills around here, but just little pockets because there's so much to eat. And I also wonder if the reduction in vultures that we have around here is perhaps a result of the fact that around the mountains they do keep what we call vulture restaurants, so they're various sort of tourism operations, and in order to attract tourists, I suppose. What they do is they attract vultures, so they'll go and find some roadkill or perhaps a hapless donkey that has been sold off by its owner. And what they'll do is sort of put it at this viewpoint, and then the vultures will come in and eat there. And I think there are a few of those around the mountains towards Hoedspruit and perhaps a bit further north of that. And what that means is that many of the vultures have probably become a resident outside of the park rather than inside, because there's just an easy meal always on offer. It's probably also got to have some effect on what I perceive to be a smaller number of vultures. Massively, massively important part of the ecology out here. Right, we're now approaching the valley of the great Mlwamati. And there we are. You see it, Jean-Ré. Great swirling torrent of water crashing down from the north. Now, of course, we are expecting a deluge this year. La Niña is apparently forming to the south of us, and so we're expecting quite a lot of rain later on this year, and it would be quite a pleasure to see this drainage line flow briefly. I think it would be astounding. I wonder if it will happen. Righty. Ooh. This is very nice. Hello, Michael. You say you'd like for us to go and have a look at the hyena dens because about a week ago you saw a female with very clear suckle marks. Michael, I think that's a great idea. It's definitely worth going to do. And so, yeah, we can certainly do that. Maybe we should start. I don't know if Jamie or Brent went. Not Jamie, well, Jamie's just got back. I don't know if Steph or Brent went towards any of the hyena dens in the last week or so. I went just before I went off to Kenya. And so I'm happy to do it again. Let's go and check the Mvubu one perhaps a little bit later today, because that would make sense. And that is often seems to be the den site to which lower ranking females go first before they join up with the rest of the clan. So yeah, definitely, Michael, we can certainly do that. And thank you for that information. Not too far yet. I'm just going to find out exactly where these leopards were. I don't seem to be able to be hearing too well. Ah, there we go. My earpiece wasn't in. Funny how that helps, you know. Right, let's go back to Tingana and Shadow, find out what they're doing, and I'll find out where Karula is.
And for now, it just seems as though our mating pair have exhausted themselves and are just taking the opportunity to enjoy the morning light. I'm just thinking about Shadow and her cub. I really, really hope that little one is still alive and well. I really liked her. She had such a character. And the last time I saw her, she was snarling at Shadow to protect her monkey kill. It's possible, Maxine. Leopard's desses do this. So Maxine's question is it possible she's mating to protect her cub to distract a male? Now, of course, this is Tingana, who is dominant in this area, and he would be one of the potential fathers. But female leopards are known for their promiscuity, so to speak, as a way of protecting the livelihoods of their cubs. And they do demonstrate false estrus after they've had cubs. I know that there are reports and articles of leopards mating almost straight after giving birth. And we've also seen the lionesses do it relatively recently. So obviously the hormones, the lactation hormones and so on, plays a role. But it's usually straight after the birth of the cub, not 6 months into their lives. And I think it's more likely that... Oh, there we go again. Thank you. once again. Just the sort of growling purr of shadow. And they keep deciding that the guari bushes will give them some privacy, screening them from the whole process, or screening us from the whole process. And both cats have gone straight back to sleep. I think it's likely that Shadow's body naturally takes her back into an estrus cycle sooner than it should. I mean, I've got no evidence for that, except for the fact that it's now 2 years in a row that we've seen her mating earlier than might otherwise be the case for, and I say this relatively carefully, a normal leopard. But nothing's normal, of course. Each and every individual has their own idiosyncrasies. But I do wonder whether or not that hasn't played a role in her lack of success. Or we could be being completely unfair to Shadow. She might have lost her cub in a different way. It's so difficult being a female leopard all on your own, raising a cub with so many different threats out there. It could even have been Salaeshe moving into her territory that caused the loss of her cub. But then again, we don't know. We're keeping our fingers crossed, but we don't know. Right. Thanks, guys. You found yourselves in the perfect position. And before we reposition, let's quickly answer Mike's question. Watching in Hawaii and hopefully enjoying our big cat spectacle this morning. She wants to know, after the mating process, because of course the leopards are terribly distracted, would they go and hunt after their mating sessions together, or will they go their separate ways? They generally go their separate ways and move off in opposite directions, usually with, I feel like, a great deal of relief, although I might just be projecting emotions on them. Leopards don't seem to enjoy their time together. They much prefer being solitary and hidden away. However, there are cases of mating leopards hunting together during their mating session. You know, if something wandered in through here, there's always a chance that they would go for it and then share the kill. The hunger prerogative is almost as strong as the mating one. So they would hunt if there is the opportunity. I've heard of a mating leopard pair sharing a giraffe kill before, which must have been extraordinary. That is not something I've ever witnessed. So it is possible, but it's relatively unusual. Let's reposition, because right now we've got spots through trees. And I think I see a relatively easy way of scuffling around here. By the way, talking about tamboti trees, those two little trees in front of me are tiny baby tambuertis. So those are the sort of things that we're avoiding whenever we're off-roading. Okay. Standing by.
Hi, Jeremy. I was driving along the fire break. It was a simple, which side you are to Sugarman?
Our orbs, we're basically halfway between Triple M and Zoe's, probably more towards, a little bit closer to Zoe's.
Well, okay, go for it, I'll go around again.
I've got your audio. Keep coming a bit further to the east of where you are. Now you should see my tracks going off the road to the north from there. There we go. Isn't that beautiful? A lovely Shadow and Tingana. And giving us a really incredible view of the comparison in size between a male and a female leopard. It's not something we always get to see, but the sexual dimorphism is actually enormous. Shadow is roughly half the size and weight of Tingana. Maybe just a little bit more, but hardly. She probably weighs somewhere in the region of about... Oh, here we go again. Tingana's adopting the if I don't move and pretend I'm asleep, she'll forget about it approach. She's going to mate with him one more time. beautiful. He's trying to pretend she's not there to lure the female. The dramatic scene of a leopard mating. All right, well, it is spots galore, so while our leopards sleep off their activities, let's jump on board with James and see whether or not he's got more spots to show you.
Look, everybody, it's been so long. You know, the last time I saw them, these little things were on a road called Elephant Carcass. They were on their own for a long time, for a few days. That was a good 5 or 6 weeks ago. So this in the tree is Hosanna, the young male. And then just below him, on the ground, resting not too far from us, her ladyship. Oh dear. Look at that. Look. Going up the tree. This is fantastic. Oh, this is brilliant. I'm the world's slowest wildlife photographer. How cool was that, everyone? So Karula taking the last piece of meat there. Why is it so want? Why shouldn't she? Mom must eat. There she is with her little piece of leg dropped by her son. Silly little fellow. Yeah, he's got a little bit more sinew now. Would you like some sinew for breakfast, Chandra? Nothing like a bit of sinew for breakfast.
Great vegetarian option.
That was just fantastic to see. Gee whiz. Karula in front of us now moving with her leg. Obviously seeking out a little bit of privacy. Oh, she's going to hoist this. No, surely not. She looked like she was going to put it in that dead tree. Let's just sit here for a little while and see if she doesn't pop her head out the other side. Otherwise, we'll move around. She is going to hoist it. How cool is that? No, not so much. Not a good spot to go. That's brilliant. Now, I know it's difficult to know where to look in a sighting like this, but little Shongile is clearly a bit irritated by her brother and the fact that he is sitting there munching away. She's hungry. And she just keeps looking up towards Hosanna, her brother. There we go. So sweet. Sally in Oregon, you want to know why I think that she hesitated to go up there? I think she hesitated, Sally, because she realized it was going to be a spiky and uncomfortable thing. I think she just thought she'd try it anyway, and then thought, this is ridiculous, and hopped back down into the comfort of the soft leaf litter. It's so very sweet. Wonderful. Right, let's just sit here for just slightly longer, and then what we'll do is move around to the other side. Now asleep. Well, not quite. She's definitely hungry, you know. She wants to go up there. But she's just a little bit reticent. Chandra, shall we try the other side? Are you happy here? No, I mean just sort of 90 degrees around.
Okay.
Let's try it, everyone. I'm just not quite satisfied with where we're sitting. So while we're here, let's go across to the aunt of these two and their father. That's how it works with Leopard Society.
Her aunt is currently consorting with the father, potentially, of Karula's cubs, as James said. A small world in leopard families and leopard genetics. I do have to move from where we are now because poor Aubrey hasn't got a view. I'm just going to wait for them to mate and then we'll shift around so that we don't ruin the sound. Okay, we can. Let's move quickly. Okay, we're not going to have the best view, but Aubrey has just joined us, so we have to be relatively fair in the way that we share out the ability to see in this particular sighting. We've had some extraordinary views. One. He got her by the back of the throat, which they'd usually do to stop the female lashing out at them straight away, but he didn't let go. So he actually dragged her back with him when he pulled away from her. And then rolling onto her back, as all big cats do, it's part of what's known as the lordosis reflex, which he's given us a clear demonstration of. Lions and leopards do it, and it's thought to help aid fertilization. They're usually quite enthusiastic about it in the beginning, and then towards the end they stop demonstrating that particular rolling over onto their back behavior. Awesome. The sound effects of leopards mating it's just unbeatable. It's more dramatic, I think, than lions mating, in my opinion. There's a little bit more in the way of scrappiness between the two of them. It's just incredible to witness. And we've been treated to some fantastic views, and hopefully these two will decide to stick around for the sunset safari. We can try and beat yesterday's drive, which was, what did we calculate it as? 26 different big cats, including little cubs? Must have been somewhere close. Seven sticks cubs, three sticks adults, that's 10, plus 1 is 11, plus 13 kahumas is 24. Plus two leopards. It's 26 big cats yesterday afternoon on the sunset safari. And we're not doing too badly this afternoon. And the fantastic morning's viewing of the different leopards of Juba. I don't want to keep you away from Karula and her wonderful little cubs for too long. Let's head back across to James.
It's a youngster. Hello again, everyone. We've moved slightly. You can see a lovely, lovely view now of the little chief, Hosanna, and the kill made by his extremely adept mother. That is an adult male, or an adult impala. I don't think it's a male, probably a female. Can you see any horns there? All I can see is a bit of liver sticking out. Very, very rich source of nutrients, the liver, everybody. So if you happen to be a leopard, it's a good piece of food to get, because it's not just protein, it's quite fatty. It's got some good stuff in it. And all the while, the little sister looks up, hopefully. Now, as we said, I've said before, and I know I've been fairly harshly contradicted by one or two viewers, which is absolutely fine. I don't think that I've never seen them feed together for very long. Yes, sometimes they feed a little bit together, but normally it's one or the other. And I think that goes along with the fact that they don't do an enormous amount of playing with each other. Nothing like their lion cubs do. And that's simply a function of the fact that they are leopards, which means that they're going to be totally solitary for most of their lives. A lovely blue sky above. Oh, look! What do you think she's going to do, Gendry? Do you think she's going to brave it or wait for him to get so full that he can't hold himself in the tree anymore? His belly is very full. You can see it there sticking out behind his left back leg. And he's got very sweet little legs and tail hanging out there. They grow up so fast, you know, Gendry. And Gendry, just quickly, sorry, there's a batalier coming in the same way that it did earlier. Look at it, flying right over the top. The same way that it did with the lion kill. Definitely seen that piece of meat there. We'll think about maybe having some, but I don't think it's going to be able to get anything from this kill. Unsurprisingly, Gendry, I didn't get a photograph of that battalion.
Very unlikely.
That is, isn't it? Yeah, the batalier would love to come in here and have a bite, but it realises with three leopards eating here, highly unlikely. And Gendry was just saying to me, wouldn't it be nice if we had Big Cat Week during the winter time? He's absolutely right, of course. Big Cat Week is in February, and we don't get anything like the views of the cats we do in the winter, because there's just so much greenery around.
Not a photo yet, James.
Of what? Of the leopard?
The
batalier. No, not with this lens and my skill. There is a hooded vulture also floating above. If you want it, Chandra. There we are. It's that small pixel up there. There you are. Well done. The leopards haven't moved, everyone, don't worry. Fear not. And it's come in for exactly the same reason that the same two species of bird arrived at the lion kill. And of course I have the ability to look both ways because I can see what Jandro is filming and I can see the little leopard in the tree who was watching exactly what we've been watching. He noticed the vulture coming in. Carol, nice question from you. You say, why is he always first at the kills? I'm not sure that he is, Carol. I think it's just that when we got here, he was eating. It's quite possible that she ate a little bit before he did. When you say, is it a male-orientated world in the animal kingdom? It's a size-orientated world entirely, Carol. So it's just got to do with the size that these animals have. So he's now probably starting to get a little bit bigger than her, which means, yes, he probably will start to feed more often than not before her, because he'll just box her off the kills. Hmm? Oh, yes. Very nice, Chandra. Oh, he's got a... seems to have a bit of stomach contents there. He might be doing some bokdrol spuch not too long from now. Quite astounding sighting. Does make one excited for breakfast, don't you find, Jean-Ré? Perhaps not for what he's eating there. I think he's there. You see, he's just opened up the stomach contents there. That's the rumen. So that's the undigested plant material that would have been stuck in the stomach. And he won't eat that, but he will eat the intestine from which it's come, because it is very nutritious as well. We had a great question yesterday about how it is that a carnivore manages to get sufficient nutrients given that they only eat meat. And here you can see, well, yes, it is animal product, but it is varied. In this case, he's eating the intestines, he's got the liver and the kidneys and the heart and the lungs, and eventually, I guess, his mother will crack open the head like a walnut and enjoy the brain, all of which contains various bits and pieces of nutrition crucial to the healthy survival of two little leopard cubs and their royal mother. Hello, Andrew in Vermont. Common query about cats, big cats out here. You say, thank you, Jean-Ré, do leopards get hairballs? Yes, I've definitely seen leopards get hairballs, absolutely. They do. They lick the carcasses of the animals they catch in order to swallow the hair, which I think helps line the digestive system. So in the same way that they eat grass sometimes for a bit of roughage, I think what you'll find is that they lick the hair to clean it off the skin to a certain extent, but also to swallow some. But inevitably, they're going to get too much in and they will eventually have to cough it up. I don't know how much hair they get from their own cleaning, which is of course where a house cat gets a hairball, but I imagine there is some, but I've certainly seen leopards coughing up hairballs before. He ain't going nowhere, that leopard, is he? His sister, she just keeps looking up, hoping desperately for a gap. Much more well-mannered than her brother. We might... we've got a little bit of time left. I think we're going to sit here for a little while and then we'll try one last reposition and get a nicer view of Shongile on the ground. She's lying very carefully in the shade, waiting patiently her turn. Okay, let's go back to Jamie and find out if Shadow and Tingana have managed to make some cousins for these two little things.
Well, hopefully not. I'm still really hoping that perhaps the cousin is still alive and well. Oh, dearie me. We've lost me completely.
Yeah, it's back now.
Is it back now? Okay. Right. No moving, Jamie. Stay absolutely still. Okay, no, we can't stay absolutely still. Kirsty says it's still soft. I'm going to take this mic. I'm going to do something similar to what Lou did yesterday with TriCaster, according to James, which was attack it with a big hammer. I don't need a big hammer for this microphone, just a little one. But there we go. Our leopards are still resting in the shade, taking a break from their cub-making activities. Although, as I said, I'm really truly hoping that that is not going to be the case now. Unfortunately, it's not looking good, is it? This is now the second time that Shadow's been mating with Tingana. Because as far as I know, she was seen mating while I was on leave as well, 10 days or so ago. So some interesting things happening in the world of our leopard dynamics. Now, just to give you a rough idea of how close we are, Kirsty was giving me an update on the fact that there was a battalier soaring around Karula's kill. We could see it at that point. It flew right over our heads. So we are probably, I would guess that and say, what's that, 200 meters or so? I can almost, in fact I can, from my angle, not from Brian's angle, I can see the tree where the kill is. It's, no Brian, you won't be able to, there's a very large curry bush in front of it. So that's how close we are. It'll be very interesting to see. Karula must know. I think it's back on that side. Just out of your reach. I'm pretty sure that Karula knows these two are here. She must do. Her hearing's more sensitive than ours, and they're not exactly subtle about their during their current activities. So we're probably about 100, no, that's an exaggeration. We're about 300 meters away, 300 yards away from Karula and her kill where James is sitting now. So not far at all. The question is, does Tingana know that she's there? I don't think so. I think otherwise he would have been making a beeline straight in that direction. And what kind of interesting dynamics would we see at play this afternoon on the sunset safari? Will these two be too wrapped up in each other to realize that a meal is just a few hundred meters away? Or will they discover it, and what will Karula do then? What will Shadow do then? It'll be very, very interesting dynamics playing out. You'd have to wait until the sunset safari, because I don't think... Oh, hold on. There's a Dacre. It's coming straight towards us. He's in front of us here, Brian. I don't think he's realised. You might not be able to see him just yet. He's just through there. Let's have a look, see if you can see movement. He stopped and froze. He's seen us, but not the leopards. There, you can just see his nose peeking in the middle of your screen. Those of you with keen eyes. There he is. Ah. Good choice, little... Good choice, little Dacre. Dashing off in the opposite direction. I wonder if he realizes how close he came to being a quick snack for our lovely leopards. This is what we spoke about earlier, the fact that if something did happen to wander into their midst, hapless and unsuspecting, they would immediately seize upon the opportunity to grab it. I think that Dacre made a very sensible decision today, going off in the opposite direction. Perhaps his eyesight was keener than I thought, but I don't think so. I think it just decided that it wouldn't want to go through that thick area anyway. Now, as the temperature starts to heat up, the frequency of their mating has slowed down, and they haven't mated since we last saw them a couple of minutes ago. I think that things are dying down for now. The sunny and warm weather has the effect of dampening their romantic mood. Now, while they snooze away in the safety and shade of a Tamburti thicket, let's jump across 300 meters or so to the east of us to where James is sitting with Karula.
Slight development here, everybody. Hosanna dropped a piece of stomach or something from the... Excuse me. Can't speak. So tummy. Stuck in my in my throat. Okay. Right. This development was that he dropped a piece of stomach or something onto the ground, and Shongile didn't even respond. She just got up to go and see if she could get a piece of leg that her mother was eating. And then Karula got up, left her leg, went to the stomach, and Shongile went to where she is now, eating the little piece of leg, and now she's very happy. Oh, there we go. Something else has been dropped. I think he's going to drop the whole thing very shortly. Hello, the Snapple attack. You want to know what a leopard does in the case of living in an open area, perhaps like the Mara. What do they do if they kill something on an open plain? Do they drag it until they find a tree, or do they just eat it there? No, they'll often just eat it there. They'll often eat on the ground, and certainly in the case of Shadow, she almost never pulls their kills up a tree. And so you'll find that if there is a convenient tree, and especially in the presence of other predators, then they will drag it up. But you know, in a very open area, you won't really find leopards. They will normally be on the fringes of an open area near the trees. Look, let's go up to the top there, Jandre. Hosanna is moving around the place. Whoa! Did you get that? That is so cool. Now, let's watch what happens. I think he's going to come down. I think he's bored. Come on, don't go down that way. Come down this way. Come on. Come down this way for us. And his sister is now waiting. It was the entire stomach. Sorry, Karula's now walking off with the entire stomach there. She's put it down into that hole where she and Shongile have been feeding. And Shongile, now underneath, hoping her brother's going to come out of the tree. Come on, look this way. That's it. Thank you. No, missed it. Can you believe it? Can you believe it? I am the world's slowest photographer ever. Oh, we've only got 2 minutes left, but we may just extend a little bit to see what plays out here. But I think we will definitely come back here, obviously, this afternoon and spend some more time with them. I don't think they're going anywhere unless this rather careless fellow manages to drop his kill. I got a photograph, Jandre. So we're just getting word from the final control as the smell of the innards of an impala waft over us. We'll just extend a little bit, everyone, and see what happens. Here he goes. Here he comes. I'm just keeping an eye on her. Let's just keep an eye on her, the little leopardess on the ground. She hasn't moved. She's still waiting, watching patiently. I think he wants to come down, but I think he's a little bit scared. He's looking at his sister now. Here he comes. grams. Well done. Very inelegant, but well done. You're down. Well done. Just wait 1 second and see what she does. I think if he takes 2 steps from the tree, she's going to go up. Look how he totally ignores her. Now watch. Let's see if she goes up. He's now investigating his mother's food, saying hi to his mum, and now here she goes. It's not an easy tree to get up, you know. I think she's reticent to try and climb it. You know, she tried when we first got in here, and it was very difficult for her. Here we go. Come on, little girl. Up you go. She's squealing. She's just making a little squealing sound. There we go. Come on. Go for it. There we go. Well done. Here you go. And mother doing a little bit of chuffing. She's going, kaw, kaw. There we go. There we go. Come on. There you are. That's it. Don't fall now. Oh, that's high. It's difficult, hey? It's not easy for her because you're going to have to stand. There we are. Now she'll eat. Oh, the balance is unbelievable. There we go. All right, everybody. Well, Shongile has her breakfast. We'll come back this afternoon. A big thank you to all of you for having or spending the time with us. It's been great to be with you. Thank you, Jandre, for your efforts. Thank you, Kirsten, in the final control with, I think it was Louise this morning. Lovely to have Louise there. I'm not sure why I said that, but it still was nice. And we'll see you this afternoon. Stay safe and happy wherever you happen to be, and we'll see you then.